There have been countless books written about the resurrection of the dead. There have been scores of sermons preached. There have been numerous tracts that have been authored. Untold speeches have been given and manuscripts penned that all have concerned the resurrection of the dead and the power of the resurrection. But still, the greatest dissertation on the sheer magnitude and the power of the resurrection of the dead is found here in 1 Corinthians 15. You will not find a better book on the resurrection. You will not find a better paper written about the resurrection. You will not hear a better sermon preached about the resurrection than what you find in the 58 some odd verses of 1 Corinthians 15. It is among the greatest chapters of the entire Bible. It is certainly the crown jewel of this 1 Corinthian letter, and it is probably the most hope-bringing text that the Apostle Paul ever penned. It begins with, "Moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preached unto you, which you have also received, and wherein you stand, having said all that has been said across 14 different problems, having ended already chapters 12, 13, and 14, that three-part discussion about miraculous gifts and their confusion of the assembly and their lack of love. He turns his attention to one of the last two problems that he will discuss in this letter, problem number 15 out of 16, which concerns the resurrection. And he begins with the gospel. "Moreover, I declare unto you the gospel, a gospel which he has already declared to them before, which I preach unto you, which you have already received, and wherein you currently stand." Verse 2, "by which," that is to say, by the gospel, "also are you saved, if you keep in memory what I have preached unto you, unless you have believed in vain." You became a Christian. See to it that your being a Christian was not for nothing, that your becoming a Christian was not for nothing, in vain. It will be for something if you take the message preached to you and you apply it. If you take the gospel that had been preached to you and you apply it to your life. Verse 3, "For I delivered unto you, first of all, how that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures." That death, burial, and resurrection constitutes, according to Paul, the foundation of the gospel. It is not itself the gospel. The death, burial, and resurrection is the beginning of the gospel. There is so much more to be said about the gospel. When a person obeys the gospel, he obeys more than just an understanding, or from just an understanding, that Christ lived, died, was buried, and rose again. He obeys the pattern of doctrine delivered to him, Romans 6. This says that it is the first of all delivered. The first thing I taught you was the death, burial, and resurrection. That is the foundation. That is the layer upon which everything is taught. Without that foundation, there is no gospel. And that's the point of 1 Corinthians 15. That is the problem concerning the resurrection. The problem is, according to 1 Corinthians 15, the Corinthians had stopped believing it. Or at least some of them had. Or at least they were being taught it and they were confused by it. The idea was being bandied around that there is no such thing as a resurrection. And so Paul will say, if there is no resurrection, then everything you have faith in, everything that your hope is built upon, is for nothing. Verse 5. "And that he," Christ, "was seen of Cephas, and then of the 12. After that he was seen of about 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain unto this present, but some are fallen asleep." And so to show that there must be a resurrection, he takes you back to the resurrection of Christ. Without the resurrection of Christ, there is no resurrection of any of us at the last day. And to show that, he first establishes that Christ's resurrection is a verifiable fact. It is an understood event which human eyes beheld. He says Cephas, and then of the 12, which you could argue the 12 then includes the other 11 other than Paul, or other than Peter, plus Matthias. But I tend to think it means Cephas, and then of all of the apostles together. And that's what he's saying. And then, of course, after that, he was seen by several countless others. He says in the next verse, 500, among whom would have been Matthias, who later became an apostle, replacing Judas. But however you want to read that, Cephas and then the 12, the point he's making overall is he was seen first of the apostles, Then he was seen of about 500 brethren. It has sometimes been argued by critics, by scoffers, that Christ's resurrection is a fairy tale, something made up by the apostles in order to convince people to listen to them, who are the teachers in following the Christian pattern. But there's a lot of flaws with that idea. First of all, if it is true that Christ really was dead and buried and the apostles somehow hid his body, first of all, what did they do with the body? How did they get to the body where the stone was sealed and shut and guards were keeping watch over the tomb? How did they get to the body? Number two, how would they, these liars, have managed to keep that lie going even into their death? A lot of people will live for a lie. A lot of people will tell other lies to protect a lie. They might even suffer for a lie, but nobody dies for a lie. That's just totally against human nature. If you put a gun to someone's head, they will break because no one is willing to actually pay that ultimate sacrifice for something they know is untrue. If the apostles hid and stole the body of Jesus and then lied, then they know they're liars. And yet each one of these apostles died for that lie. That itself proves it wasn't a lie to begin with. But beyond that, he was seen of 500 plus individuals. 500 people saw him, could verify with their two eyes, we saw Jesus. And you see record of that, just snippets of it at the tail end of the gospel account. He met two men on the road to Emmaus. Several came and went to touch his feet, according to Matthew 28. He saw Mary Magdalene, of course, at the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, where he had been buried or been laid. So countless people saw him. He says, of those 500 plus, the greater part of them are still alive. Many of them, you could go, you could look them up in the phone book, and you could talk to them about their seeing the resurrected Christ. If this is just one big conspiracy, if this is one big lie, somebody would have broken. Somebody would have given it up. Somebody would have let slip the lie, and then the whole thing would have been ruined. It never happened. Verse 7. After that, he was seen of James, and then of the all of the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due season. Of all the apostles, leads me to believe that that refers now to Matthias and them again collectively. And then of James, of course, that being his brother. And then of all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen of me also, showing the progression of who saw him and when they saw him. He would have been seen of Matthias later, and then of Paul, those two who had to be seen of the Lord, who had to see the Lord, rather, so that they might be qualified as apostles. Last, he was seen of me also, as one born out of due time. Paul says, me who came for a specific purpose, who might preach to the Gentiles. That was his reason for preaching and his for being an apostle. For I am least of the apostles. Of course, he says that, no doubt, out of reflection from his past life of sin, persecuting the church. I am not meet to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. You see his mindset there. Of course, Paul was forgiven of his sins. He should not have harbored any ill will toward his own past, as God doesn't anymore. But human beings sometimes struggle with letting go and forgiving, certainly forgiving themselves. Verse 10. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. That's him saying, I may not have been a good person. He says, sometimes I don't think I am a good person presently, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. That is to say, saved, having hope in Christ. In spite of my own disappointment in myself, Paul says, I am still thankful to have Christ in my life. And his grace which was bestowed upon me, his unmerited, his unwarranted, his undeserved favor which came upon me, that it was not in vain. How was it not in vain? I labored more abundantly than they all. In other words, Paul says, I may not be the best person to be an apostle, so I'm going to work that much harder than the apostles. Of course, he doesn't say that to try to say he's better than. It just comes from just the opposite. It's his own grief for his past that makes him want to work that much harder. That's all he's saying. Yet not I, but the grace of God which is in me. And so even though he sometimes reflects negatively on his past, when he shouldn't reflect on it at all, he still recognizes his present as one saved in Christ, willing to go and preach and teach. Verse 11. Therefore, whether it were I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. So whether it was me, Paul, or they, that is, all of the other men who ever preached and taught, all the other ones who ever saw the risen Savior, whether it's me or them, I preached, and you believed. We all preached who saw the resurrected Christ, that he was resurrected. We preached that foundation of the gospel, and you, Corinthians, believed it. You originally believed in the resurrection, among other things. Verse 12, now if Christ be preached that he rose from the dead, How is it some say among you that there is no resurrection of the dead? If, based on all that he just said, true preachers, gospel preachers, honest preachers teach there is a resurrection, who among you is then saying there isn't a resurrection? If only the true preachers say there is, the ones saying there isn't must not be true preachers. Stop listening to them. Some among you are saying there is no resurrection. Verse 13, but if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ is not risen. If you won't rise when you die, if there is no such thing, if it's not feasibly possible, then Christ didn't rise. And if Christ is not risen, then our preaching is vain and your faith is vain. Then everything I preached, and this ties back with the earlier verse, so we preached and you believed. If Christ isn't risen, then everything I preached was nothing, and everything you believed was likewise nothing. Yea, and we are found false witnesses of God. We are all liars. Not just deceived, they would be the deceivers. The Corinthians would be the deceived. They would be the poor saps who believed the lie. But these apostles would be the deceivers. And incidentally, Paul himself is personally a perfect proof of the resurrection of Christ. As he was not originally a disciple of the Lord, he was a persecutor of the church. And for some reason, he changed his stripes. He went from bad to good. He went from persecutor to persecuted. He went from attacker of the church to believer in the church. So how is it that a person like that would make that kind of a change? Could any regular, ordinary Christian convince Paul? No, he would have arrested him, as he had been doing. Could any apostle have convinced Paul? No, he would have arrested him and tried him for spreading false untruths, for spreading falsehoods, as the critics say the apostles did. So what reason does Paul have for changing? The resurrection is the only logical explanation. And as he says here, if there isn't a resurrection, I'm a liar. I've not just been lied to, I am a liar. We are false witnesses of God then, because we have testified, that is, we've taken an oath, testified of God that he raised up Christ, whom if he raised not up, then the dead don't rise. Let me word it again. Whom he raised not up, if it is so that the dead aren't risen. In other words, if dead people don't rise, then God didn't raise up Christ, and I'm a liar for saying he did. Verse 16, for if the dead do not rise, then is Christ not raised. There's a lot of repetition in this, but he says the phrase in order to make his point. In this text, it's very different from most of Paul's chapters where he makes an argument, where typically he builds and builds and builds and builds for half the chapter, and then spends the other half of the chapter very meticulously, methodically breaking down that argument and showing exactly what he believes and why. He doesn't do that here. In chapter 15, at least for the first part of it, he gives you a series of smaller arguments. If this is true, then this is true. And if this isn't true, then neither is this. And he does that just almost like bullet points. Well, here he says, verse 16, if the dead do not rise, then Christ isn't raised. And if Christ is not raised, your faith is vain and you are still in your sins. You can't have it both ways. These false teachers who are saying there isn't a resurrection, well, then what they're saying is there is no salvation. Because there is no salvation without a resurrection. If Christ did not raise, if that body whose soul was left from it and that shell of that body was just left and covered and wrapped and put in a tomb, if that spirit did not go back into that body and come back up, awake and alive, then nobody is saved. If Christ didn't rise, there is no salvation for any of us. We're still in our sins. Verse 18, then they also which are fallen asleep in Christ are perished. Then our dead Christian brethren, our loved ones who have died already, they are not just dead and awaiting resurrection to go to paradise or to go to heaven itself. They are perished. They're gone for good and forever. Verse 19, if in this life only we have hope in Christ, we are of all men most miserable. If all I have to look forward to is the time I have remaining on this planet, if I have no hope of a resurrection beyond this world, then my life suddenly has a whole new perspective, a far worse perspective. I become not a man of hope, not a man of optimism, not a man that's looking at silver linings and in dark clouds of persecution, but rather I become a man most miserable. If there is no resurrection, we have no reason to continue suffering on this world. We might as well just put bullets in our heads and end the pain. If there is no resurrection, and furthermore, he won't make this argument until later, but there is no, really, he doesn't make it at all, but he certainly could have. If there is no resurrection, then God is a liar, as he promised there would be one. And if God is a liar, then there is no such thing as God, and I might as well put that bullet in my head, because there is no hell if there is no God, and there is no heaven if there is no God. So he says, if all I have is this life, and if the hope I have in heaven that is to say, through a resurrection, if that is a lie and it's only a hope I can have while I'm here, if in this life only we have hope, then we are of all men most miserable. Verse 20, but now is Christ risen from the dead. It's true, he did rise. And become the first fruits of them that slept. Your dead loved ones are not really dead. They're sleeping. Their spirits have left their body. That is the physical definition of death. But their spirits will just as easily return to their bodies through the working of Christ and be risen from the dead. Just as simply, just as gently as waking someone from sleep. That's why Christians call death sleep throughout the New Testament. But he says here, if Christ is risen, then he became the first fruits. He became the first one, the forerunner of those that sleep now. He died and rose again, setting the template for those later who have died, who will therefore rise again. He did it first. We'll do it after. He's the first fruits. We come second. 21. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. This is sounds exactly like the way Paul argued in Romans chapter 5. If through one man's sin, death entered the world, then through one man's righteousness, Christ, will life come in to the world. That's basically a summary of Romans chapter 5. Well, here he words it, for since by man came death, by man, Christ, came resurrection of the dead. And those are, of course, the two Adams, as he says in verse 22. For as in Adam, all die. Why do all die because of Adam? Because of Adam, I have no access to the tree of life. Because of Adam, I can't live perpetually in this physical body. But because of Christ, I can touch the tree of life spiritually, and I can live forever and ever in paradise with him. As in Adam all die, even so in Christ, the second Adam, shall all be made alive. Verse 23, but every man in his own order. There's an order to follow. This comes first, then this, then this. Christ the first fruits, afterwards, see the order, they that are Christ at his coming. First I will die, then Christ will return, then I will rise from the dead. There's a pattern to follow. Then comes the end, when he shall have delivered up the kingdom to God, even the Father, the kingdom being the church of Christians who live on this earth. He will deliver up the kingdom to God, even the Father, when he shall have put down all rule and all authority and power. When he comes back, the kingdom, which is already here when he returns, will be delivered to the hands of the Father. Verse 25, and then he must reign, having put down, it said in the earlier verse, all power and rule and authority, that is, of this world. He will finally and completely eliminate it, and then he will reign till he has put, for he must reign presently, till he has put all enemies under his feet. But then after he's done that, then he will deliver the kingdom to the Father. He must reign presently now, as a king now. Some say Christ isn't a king right now, but Paul says otherwise. The last enemy that shall be destroyed, verse 26, is death. That one great enemy. Christians sometimes get confused in the hope of a resurrection and equate that with death as an enemy. Death is not, or death as our friend. Death is not our friend. Death is not something that is good. Death is something bad. It is the result of something bad, sin. But we are freed from that enemy. There is good in spite of that bad, and that is resurrection from the dead. And that last enemy that shall be destroyed is death itself, because when Christ returns and the dead rise, those dead Christians who rise will rise never to be separated again, the word death means. 27, for he has put all things under his feet, but when he says all things are put under him, it is manifest that he is accepted, which did put all things under him. God put all things under Christ except himself. God put all things under Christ except God, that is to say. Verse 28, and when all things shall be subdued unto him, then shall the Son also himself be subject unto him that put all things under him, that God may be all in all. After all things are under Christ, that is when he returns, then he will put himself under the Father. Verse 24, as it says in the beginning of verse 24, then comes the end when he delivers up the kingdom to God, even the Father. So that's a very wordy, kind of almost confusing way of saying all things are under Christ except God. And when Christ returns, he will deliver the kingdom up to God. To what end? So that God may be all in all. Verse 29. Otherwise, that is, if there is no resurrection, what shall they do which are baptized for the dead if the dead do not rise at all? Why then are they baptized for the dead? Why are you baptized? Because of dead Christians. That phrase, for the dead, has given some a very wrong impression that has caused some to think, well, you have a dead loved one who wasn't a Christian, so you can become a Christian for them. No, it doesn't work that way. You get one chance in this life, and then after this life is over, that's it. What he says here, why were you, in thinking about those dead loved ones, why did you become a Christian and stay faithful if you're not going to see them again? That's his point. His point is about the resurrection. He makes the point by saying, why were you baptized? Why did you become a Christian in light of these dead loved ones if those dead loved ones won't rise, if the dead don't rise at all? Why do we stand in jeopardy every hour? Why do we risk death if we have no hope of living again? We're wasting our time. I protest, verse 31, by your rejoicing which I have in Christ our Lord, I die daily. In other words, I risk my life constantly. I am putting myself on the line daily. Why would I do that if I have no resurrection? I have praise for you despite the things I have to say against you, but I protest you by your rejoicing which I have in Christ Jesus, but I am risking my life constantly for you. If, verse 32, after the manner of men, I have fought with beasts at Ephesus, what advantage is it to me if the dead do not rise? Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we die. That would be the attitude if there is no resurrection. Just eat, drink, and be merry. We'll just die tomorrow, but who cares? But he says, if I fought, beast could be maybe he fought a tiger, probably refers to bloodthirsty individuals. He refers to bad people who were like animals, and they're attacking him at Ephesus, in this case. Well, what advantage is it that I risk my life against these kinds of people if I have no hope of a resurrection? I should just get drunk and celebrate and party. If I die tomorrow, who cares? Be not deceived. Evil, my Bible says communications, the King James, communications, better translated, associations. Evil manners of life. Evil company corrupts good manners. In other words, some of these people that you're associating yourself with who are saying there is no resurrection eventually is going to lead you, if not already, into coming to the conclusion that you can just live your life and have fun however you want it. And certainly you could if there is no resurrection. If there is no no judgment to come, and if there is no resurrection, then we're not being raised for judgment, then there would be no judgment. Then the next logical step is to say, then just eat, drink, and be merry. But be not deceived. Those evil people are going to corrupt your good manner of life. Instead, awake to righteousness. Open your eyes and be aware of what is right and wrong. And sin not. For some have not the knowledge of God, those false teachers. I speak this to your shame. Who? Anyone who would follow those false teachers. Verse 35. But some men will say, how are the dead raised up, and with what body do they come? So some people want to argue technicalities. They want to try to scientifically discuss, how is a person going to be raised? I mean, if you put someone 6 feet under in the ground, over hundreds and thousands of years, eventually they're going to decompose. Not everybody's buried. Some people are cremated. Some people's ashes are scattered in outer space. Some people have cinder blocks put on their feet and they're dumped in the Hudson River. All kinds of people die in all kinds of different ways and their bodies deteriorate and dissolve. Some people's heads are chopped off and put in this continent and their body is buried in another continent. And so people want to argue the technicalities. Listen, God made Adam from dust. He can put your body back together for resurrection. As he says, thou fool, that which you sow is not quickened except it die. In other words, you can't get the flower to grow unless you plant the seed. And that which you sow not that body that shall be but bare grain. It may be a chance of wheat or some other grain. In other words, you're planting a seed in order to get the flower. You don't plant a flower to get a flower. You plant a seed to get a flower. You're planting a body. It doesn't matter what kind of seed it is. It's going to grow the flower, the resurrected body that God wants it to be. In other words, stop quibbling over the details that's on God's side of the spectrum. God handles the resurrection. Let me handle living my life faithfully so that when I die, I will have a good resurrection. God gives it a body as it has pleased him, and every seed his own body. Verse 38. You worry about being the seed that God can plant, he'll worry about what kind of flower it turns out to be when it grows. Don't argue technicalities. All flesh is not the same flesh. There is one kind of flesh of men, another kind of flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. In other words, there are different kind of bodies for different kind of creatures. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial. There are bodies made for space and bodies made for the ground. There are bodies made for the sky and bodies made for the ocean. There are bodies made for heaven and bodies made for earth. Not the heavens, I mean heaven where God dwells, and bodies made for the ground below, this physical world. And so if your argument is, well, heaven is a spiritual place, I have a physical body, so how can my physical body be resurrected to live in heaven? Let God handle what kind of body you have. He gave different kind of bodies for different animals to serve on this earth. A fish has gills and not lungs, but I need lungs, not gills. He gave me a body I need, as he did with fish and so forth. He'll give you a body that you need for heaven as well. There is one glory of the sun, another glory of the moon, two bodies that are in space, but very different. Another glory of the stars, for one star differs from another star in glory. Of course, the sun is a star, but this is a star that we revolve around, that is just enough light, that is just far enough away for us to live on this planet. But the other stars in this universe are also there and are given the kind of bodies, figure of speech, that God wanted them to have. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown, that dead body, in corruption, because the body decays, but it is raised in incorruption. It'll be given a new body. That soul that left the body and the body behind decays, when that soul re-enters the body, it will re-enter a new kind of body, that one that will not decay, incorruption. Verse 43, it is sown in dishonor. That is the opposite of glory, the way he'll use the word here in a moment. It is raised in glory. It is a body that is not spiritual. They will become a body that is spiritual. It's a physical body that will later be risen to be a spiritual one. There is a natural body and a spiritual body. And he shows the distinction there in the earlier verses. Verse 45. And so it is written, the first man, Adam, was made a living soul. How so? Because his soul was placed in that physical body. The last man, Adam, was made a quickening spirit, which is the same words, just worded differently. Quickening, living, spirit, soul. Adam was given a physical body for his spiritual soul. Jesus was as well. But Jesus also was given a spiritual body when he ascended into heaven. So will we as well. Verse 46. Howbeit that was not first which is spiritual, but that which is natural, and afterward that which is spiritual. In other words, first you start with a physical body, like Jesus did, and then later you'll have a spiritual body, like Jesus does. So will we. 47. The first man is of the earth, earthly. The second man is the Lord from heaven, heavenly that is. And as is the earthly, such are they that are heavenly. And as is the heavenly, such are they that are heavenly. And as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. He gave me a body exactly like I need to breathe in physical oxygen or earthly oxygen, to exhale carbon dioxide, feet to walk in the ground, hands and fingers and thumbs to manipulate the world around me, eyes to see, ears to hear. He gave me a body for this physical world that relies on senses, empirical evidence, and so forth. But he will later give me a body exactly like I need for a heavenly realm. Verse 49. And as we have borne the image of the earthly, we shall also bear the image of the heavenly. The same God who gave one will give the other. 50. Now this I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, neither does corruption inherit incorruption. Your physical body can't go to heaven. Your spiritual body will. And it will be this a body that houses your living soul, just like your physical body now does, but the body itself will be spiritual as well. Verse 51, behold, I show you a mystery. I show you something that is hidden that will be one day revealed. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. Not everybody's going to die. If the Lord returns right now, all of us who are living right now, May 22nd, 2013, on planet Earth, will not have died. Not everyone will sleep, but everyone will be changed in a moment. That's how quickly. In the twinkling of an eye, faster than a blink, at the last trump. For the trumpet shall sound, and the dead shall be raised incorruptible. Paul paints the picture here of the second coming, similar to the way he wrote it in 1 Thessalonians 4. The dead rise first, meet the Lord in the air. Those who are asleep will rise first. The dead rise first to meet, and then those who are alive will meet the Lord with them in the air. That's 1 Thessalonians 4. Verse 53, for this corruptible must put on incorruption. This physical, whether it's alive or dead, will put on spiritual. Corruptible must put on incorruption. This mortal, physical body, that if you don't put a gun in my head, if the Lord doesn't return before I die, it will eventually, one day, like an old clock, just wear down and stop ticking. This physical body, this mortal, will though put on immortality. It will be given a body that won't wear out and die. It will be given a body that won't decay and corrupt. So when this corruptible, 54, has put on incorruption, when this mortal has put on immortality, then will be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. That's Isaiah 25:8. Death is swallowed up. There is no more death. Death is completely consumed so that there's no inkling of it left. Death is swallowed up in victory. Because I'm saved, when I die, I beat death. My soul will leave its body, you call that death, but my soul lives forever, and it will be given a new body to continue living. So really, death is simply just the turning of a page, the transition from one body to another. It is not an end. Death is swallowed up in victory. Death is winning. And then, after he says death is winning, he taunts death, and he taunts Satan, the wielder of death, as his sword. Oh, death! Where is thy sting, then? If I weep when a loved one dies, that is the sting of death, but is it permanent? No. If that loved one is a Christian, I'll see them again, and therefore the sting fades away. So where is the sting? It's not permanent. Oh, grave, where is thy victory? When a loved one dies and they go 6 feet under and the dirt is spread over the tomb so that all that's left in the years later when you go to visit and put flowers on the graveside is just a mound, until eventually it's no longer even just a mound. It's just flat and a little white tombstone. There is no finality to that, though. It may look like finality to physical eyes, but once I inherit a spiritual body, the victory is present. The victory becomes self-evident because that person I was looking at 6 feet under is now inhabited by a new body that I will see forever. So there is no loss. There's victory. There is no pain, no sting. The sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. Why is the sting of death sin? Because I will die, but I didn't have to sin. And because the wages of sin is death, the sting of death is sin. I mean, death is the actual object that is the enemy, but the pain of that object, the sting of it, is sin. But as he just said in the other one, there is no sting anymore. It's taken away because my sin is taken away through Christ. The stinger of the bee is taken away, so the bee can't hurt me anymore. The sting of it is gone. The sting of death is sin, but that sin's taken away. The strength of sin is the law of Moses. Why is the strength of sin the law of Moses? Because what did the law of Moses do? Or what does law do, period? It magnifies what is right and wrong. The law of Moses puts a spotlight, or law in general, puts a spotlight on right and wrong, so that you know when you're going 55, you know you're breaking the law because there's a little speed limit that says 55. If that wasn't there, you'd still be breaking the law. But that speed limit sign is the law. It tells you you're breaking the law. It puts a spotlight on your disobedience. Thus, the strength of sin, the magnification of sin, comes from the law. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Victory over sin. Victory over the old law of Moses, which couldn't take away sin. Victory over, finally, greatly, death. Thanks be to God, which gives us victory through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, that is to say, through the resurrected Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, for as much as you know that your labor is not in vain in the Lord. Be steadfast, be stubborn in the face of liars who say there is no resurrection. Be unmovable, be not wavering in your commitment, not swaying in your faithlessness. Always abounding, always having hope, always going above and beyond, let's put it that way. Always abounding in your work of the Lord. Why? Because you know your labor is not for nothing. you know there is a resurrection. If there wasn't a resurrection, all the work, all the effort, all the trials, all the tribulation, all the persecution you've gone through would be for nothing. But because you know there is a resurrection, and because you know it will take you from this life to something far greater, if you know that, then you know there is nothing, nothing this world could throw at you that should waver your faith, that should make you anything less than steadfast and unmovable. Because you know there's a resurrection, this whole world could be against you. And if you're a Christian, it is. But it doesn't matter, because it's not for nothing, your faith in Christ. There is a resurrection, and it is very much worth it. So live faithfully. That ends 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We'll pick up 1 Corinthians 16 and the 16th and final problem that Paul will deal with in this letter, which is just a brief portion of the chapter concerning giving to saints in need. But that's 1 Corinthians 15, the most beautiful chapter on the resurrection, the most in-depth study one could have on the resurrection, just concerning inspired authorship, 1 Corinthians 15. Thank you so much.